Coming to us from Turkey, Tolga Duraz is a protective coating specialist. He's also an instructor for NACE International and SSPC. Jim Kunkel here. Make sure that you subscribe to my channel and set the notification bell to all so that you won't miss any of my new content. Welcome to Thursdays with Tolga. Today, Tolga and I will be talking about corrosion under insulation, or CUI as it's known in the industry. I hope you enjoy our conversation. Hey, Tolga, how you doing today?
Hi, Jim. I'm fine. I'm great. How are you doing today?
Doing real well. So what topic are we going to cover this Thursday?
James, we are going to talk about a very highly underestimated, very important topic about corrosion under insulation, or also known as CUI in the world.
Okay.
In the literature.
Hey, so let's go ahead and we'll get started. So the first question I have for you, and I'm sure everyone else watching has the same question as well. Corrosion under insulation, or CUI, you know, what is it and, you know, what does it do?
Basically, defined very simply, we can say that corrosion under insulation is any type of corrosion that occurs within the insulation system due to the presence of moisture, oxygen, or other corrodents. But be careful about that. There is also CUF, which is very similar. It's corrosion under fireproofing, which has the same, very similar mechanism and very similar preventive actions that can be make an analogy with CUI. So we will, but we will for, mainly focusing on CUI, not CUF. But it's very well known since 1950s, but the interest get higher and higher since 1983, which we will cover in the resources slides. There is a NACE publication, which is published on published in 1985. So basically, what the all the literature, all the trainings or standards are saying that carbon steel, there are two types of steel that are exposed to this kind of corrosion. There is one carbon steel under insulation, which is operating at from minus 4 degrees Celsius to 175, or let's say in imperial, from 25 to 283 Fahrenheit. And there is also a stainless steel substrate for pipes, like duplex steel or austenitic steel. But in this case, the temperatures changes to 50 degrees to 150 degrees to, and which is imperial units, to 123 to 347 Fahrenheit. And these are very well documented in some of the highly respected organizations like NACE, API, with that we will come, American Petroleum Institute, or CINNI in Europe, but we will all come later on in our episode. And this CUI is quite dangerous, maybe because of it can be 20 times faster than atmospheric corrosion, so it, which means 1.5 to 3 millimeters of corrosion metal loss a year. So why, what is the reason behind that? We will come in a minute, Jim. And let's recall the corrosion cell members from our last episode that we have done together, the corrosion basics. There is corrosion, there is anode, which is the corroding metal. In our case, the insulated pipe. There is cathode, which is the protected part. And there is electrolyte, which is the medium, this conductive medium, and there is electrical path that is needed, required for the corrosion to take place. So why it's important? Because there are two common types of corrosion observed as a result of these corrosion mechanisms. There is one pitting corrosion. This is a localized, is simply said, pitting corrosion is a localized corrosion type, which is like pits in some very specified, very localized places, not all over the steel. And that is more dangerous than uniform corrosions of steels. And there is external stress corrosion cracking, or let's say in simple, in abbreviation ESCC, especially for stainless steel, which is can be seen is like small cracks that can be seen visually or with the use of microscopes. And let me say, this is our system, insulation system. What is that insulation system? There is an outer jacket. So let's say this is a pipe and this is an insulation system of this pipe. There is an outer jacket of this pipe that is used for mainly for protection of outdoor mechanical damage. So there is an insulation material that we will come later, which is most of the time fibrous or material. And there is protective coating. Ideally, it should be a protective coating in each insulation system. And there is the insulated substrate, which is carbon steel or stainless steel. And the problem with this system is, in ideal world, there is no corrosion under insulation. But if there is any failure of any of these members, outer jacket, insulation, protective coating, then there is there are corrosion parameters, like we will see. What are the corrosion parameters, like oxygen, rainwater, dissolved species like chlorides and sulfates, cyclic temperatures, and moisture under insulation, that are attacking attacks the substrate, the carbon steel or stainless steel insulated substrate. So in each of these parameters, two are very important. I mean, each are important, but two are very quite critical. One is the cyclic temperatures, and the other one is moisture under insulation. So what do we mean by moisture under insulation or cycling in temperatures? Firstly. So in each of these insulated pipes, most of the time, Jim, there are heated or cooled fluids that is coming, flowing through. So then therefore the steel and the coating and insulation are all heat up, and there is a moisture movement, or that we call moisture gradient. But not all the time there is heating. There are sometimes cooling because of the moisture maintenance issues or not operational, not the pipe, the pipe not being operational, so the cooling issues. So there is a moisture movement up and down from steel to outer jacket and from the outer jacket to steel. And because of that, there is the corrosion cell that is operating all the time because of this moisture movement. So there are six moisture sources we will be discussing right now. This rain, water leaks, condensation, leaking process fluids, because this is most of the time the pipes are used for flowing the fluids. So there is leaking sometimes. And deluge systems for cooling, and mist spray from cooling towers, the deluge system for fire protection system. So these are the main six moisture sources that causes corrosion under insulation. James, would you like to add anything about corrosion under insulation, moisture, or the sources, the cyclic temperature, or the parameters, Jim?
Well, like any type of corrosion cell, you know, it can be formed anywhere, and obviously under insulation is a bed opportunity for corrosion to start and to manifest. Corrosion under insulation, obviously, I think people will realize how catastrophic it can be, because it's something that if you're not regularly looking for it or testing for it, you might not know exactly where it's at, how bad it is, or how critical of potential failure there might be. So, you know, typically, Tolga, what industries is CUI most found in? And then could you give some reasons why CUI is predominant in those industries that it's most observed in?
Jim, if we briefly summarize what industries worldwide, we see that there are six of these industries. So first of all, oil and gas, refineries, the temperatures, pressures fluctuating. There is chemical industries like pharmaceutical or paint industry. There is petrochemical industries, the temperature and pressure and all sorts of parameters are changing so frequently. And there is marine and maritime industries like ships, docks, all sorts of insulated items there. And there is finally the offshore industry. This is the drilling, the oceans, the ocean water, drilling equipment, so temperatures changing. So basically these are the things, but if you ask me, Jim, what are the major common reasons? I would say there are three ones. This one is the pipes and piping in these industries, in these five industries are huge amounts. For example, I can give you an example of a refinery. In a typical refinery, like a Chevron refinery, there is 5,000 miles of piping. So like 8,000 kilometers of piping in a standard refinery. So you can see that there is a lot of points or a lot of areas of risks that are corrosion, that are prone to CUI. And there is also extreme temperatures. These industries are exposed to extreme temperatures. What I mean by extreme temperatures is, for example, from the offshore industry, I can say there are minus Celsius degrees temperatures to refineries, something like 400, 500 Celsius degrees or 1000 Kelvin, 1000 Fahrenheit we are talking about. So the temperatures are quite shocking. So because of this high temperature change, there is extreme condensation, Jim. So that's the three amounts makes the situation worse and worse. And because of that, in each year, studies show that this COI costs billions. And from a major U.S. petrochemical complex survey, two-year survey, approximately 35 of these incidences of corrosion failures are because of the corrosion under insulation. So basically, these five industries are very important in CUI. And because of the temperature, extreme temperatures and extreme condensation risks, there are CUI issues throughout the year, Jim. So would you like to add anything more, Jim, to these facts?
Yeah, I think those industries, obviously, they are critical in a lot of different aspects of our life when it comes to energy, when it comes to, major transportation and things like that. But if a catastrophic event happens because of CUI, it could be very damaging to the environment, to an economy. It could also cause a lot of issues related to, localized production. If a refinery has to go down because of a major corrosion incident, because of corrosion under insulation, really be a big impact. I do appreciate going through all those. So, when we're talking about corrosion under insulation, so obviously we're looking at these pipes that are running. They've got all this insulation on it. There's thousands of miles of pipe and probably almost that equal to insulation on most of the pipes as well. Is it possible for professionals to inspect for CUI? And if so, what are some of the methods and techniques that can be used in the inspection process?
You're right, Jim. There are inspection techniques, but first of all, why the inspection is important is for a regular coating issue, and for, also the insulation. For the insulation systems, there is three steps of the project. One is the proper selection of the insulation material based on written facts like case histories tests, and second one is the surface preparation of the material, and the third one application. But there is one important key issue, key specification, this inspection and testing. And this inspection and testing is so critical in COI, in terms of COI, that long-term healthy project can be ensured. So what are the COI inspection techniques or equipments? I can say that there are five of them, let's say, and there are other than visual, by the way. So you can, for example, this is, as you know, this is an hidden corrosion. So you, most of the time, as you have mentioned, as you have stated very nicely, correctly, you cannot see it directly with your vision, with your eyes. So visual inspection is sometimes not an alternative, it's not a probability. So you need to have some kind of an non-destructive or some kind of advanced technologies like ultrasonic. So, but for the ultrasonic, we need to cut plugs. So these plugs may be sometimes not so useful for the insulation system because this is source of moisture leakage, and this can be also this can be the right spot for detecting the corrosion, but it may be not the right spot for detecting the corrosion under insulation. So this is a very preliminary, very basic inspection technique, ultrasonic. But when we go move forwards, there is eddy current technique, which is a more specialized, more advanced technique equipments that can be used with advanced equipments and advanced trained operators. So I will not go into details, by the way, because this is also a topic of another episode. And there is X-ray inspection techniques, equipments. So basically it can be divided into three subcategories: real-time radiography, computed radiography, and digital detector arrays, DDA, flat panel detectors. And followed by X-ray, there is remote TV monitoring. This is a more conventional, more traditional thing. So it's a robotic inspection crawlers. You send it into a pipe, and you remotely observe visually with the use of a TV monitoring. And lastly, there is electromagnetic devices which have electromagnetic sensors on it. It's a very highly the HALIS sensors, and I will not go into detail because these are all topic of another episode or trainings. So would you like to add anything more to COI inspection, Jim?
Well, and I think when you look at COI inspection, you know, and I'm thinking of career path for a protective coatings inspector. You know, we've covered, you and I, in topic and conversation here on YouTube, we've talked about the protective coatings inspector, the concrete coatings inspector. We talked about fireproofing inspection because of intumescent coatings and things like that. Mm-hmm. This is also another career path opportunity for the, let's say, the protective coatings inspector, mm-hmm. to also take on training and certification to be able to identify and to be able to offer a solution in dealing, mitigating, remedying corrosion under insulation. So I appreciate you going through that.
But definitely, you're right. And I will also have, if you have time, we can also, I will also show some of the slides that you're right that this is a different career pathway. And we will maybe discuss about that later in our episode.
Yes, I think we could probably do something related to career path of an inspector. Mm-hmm. So, you know, when we're looking at CUI, how can we prevent CUI? Is there any specific, you know, materials or techniques that can be used for really long-term protection or long-term solution?
James, there are actually yes, in every technology there is solution. So for the corrosion under insulation issue, there is four main components and four main solutions. So I will not go into details for all of the items, but for the insulation materials and for the protective coatings, I will just touch upon a little. And for example, for the insulation material and corrosion inhibitor and waterproofing, like tapes and wraps and protective coatings, these are can be used separately or in conjunction with each other. So maybe a system. So let's touch upon or let's make a little bit detailed insulation materials. In the industry, there is a tendency for above freezing insulation systems to use these kind of materials like fiberglass, elastomeric plastics, like elastomeric rubber, like mineral wool, for the temperatures above 0 degrees Celsius. But when you go to below freezing degrees, there are a lot, and there is another different set of materials like polyisocyanurates, polystyrenes, cellular glass, phenolics. So these are the main types of the insulating materials that can be used in different industrial applications in the different temperature ranges. But when we come to protective coating issue, as you said, it's a different path. If this different carrier, but because there is a lot of information, like there are paints, that can be used, but we should be careful about, like epoxies, liquid organic, not all the types, but special types like phenolics, Noolax, and FBEs, like fusion bonded epoxies, like urethanes and polyurethanes, tapes and shrink sleeves, powder coatings, coltan asphalt-based coatings, titanium-modified inorganic polymers, copolymers or TMICs, mineralization coatings, and lastly, thermal spray coatings, as we have discussed in our earlier episode, especially thermal spray aluminum that is used in the CUI for preventing CUI in protective coatings, as a protective coating. So, but there are some I will not go into detail, but basically there are some basic principles for coating selection consideration, like system operating temperatures. Not all the paint or coatings are suitable, because, you know, as we have talked, there is a wide range of temperatures, starting from minus degrees to all the way up to 400, 500, 600 degrees Celsius, or like 1,000 Fahrenheit, 1,200,000 Fahrenheit. So it's very range. So the application and site requirements, what are the application and site requirements of these paints? That we want surface preparation requirements, like what are the surface profile needed? What is the surface cleanliness needed? So this is also should be considered. And what if the material is compatible with the insulating material? So not all the coatings, protective coatings, are compatible with the insulating material. So therefore, we need to be very careful about the selection of the protective coating in conjunction with the insulating materials. Anything you would like to add for protective coating for CUI? James?
No, I think you covered a lot to that, you know, and this has been a very, very good conversation we've been having. And I think we've also uncovered a lot of other opportunity to have further discussions on other topics related to CUI insulation and the protection or the mitigation of CUI. You know, in closing out this Thursday conversation with you, you know, is there anything that we didn't cover that you'd want to leave with the viewers?
Yes, James. Actually, as we have very early in the episode, this CUI is not a new issue in the corrosion business. Actually, it starts with 1971 with ASTM standard C692. And there is the ASTM STP 880 in 1965 published publication or a collection of publication published in 1965. So symposium papers and presentations. So I do recommend people to look at in details the ASTM STP 880. And there is ASTM other standards, and there is API, American Petroleum Institute standards, that I will not go into detail. There is also European Federation coding book. It's a green book. They call it Green Book series, and this is the 55 volume 55 book on corrosion and under insulation guideline. So I also recommend this book. And there is an NACE ARP. I also benefited from this standard very much. NACE recommended practice 0189/2017 edition. And there is NACE core completion book for corrosion under insulation. And there is even a software, is a application for the prediction and assessment of CUI for CUI compass. So namely, it's a CUI complex compass software. So, and there is a NACE this training, as you have mentioned before. Societies in United States and in Europe and in Australia are giving trainings or offering trainings to people, to professionals like for corrosion and protective coatings. So NACE is offering a corrosion under insulation course. This is a course that can be reached with this link. So you may also include in the description below in your video if you want, Jim. And there is SSPC course, as you have told, is an online course. This is an insulation inspector level 1 training e-course with the level 2 certification exam. So this is a program for level 1 and level 2. So I will not go into detail. Probably you may know better than me. So here is the link that you can also share with our audiences. And lastly, I can say we live in general, but we live in detail from the infamous British mathematician Alfred Whitehead. So because there are a lot of topics, subjects, and concepts about corrosion under insulation, as we have talked together, Jim. But these are just the basics. We cannot cover all of the things in this 30 minutes or 35 minutes of discussion. So I would say thank you very much to you. And if you have any questions from you or from our audiences, you can send me from the link below with this email. And anything you would like to add to this, our discussion on corrosion under insulation, Jim?
Well, what I'm going to do for the viewers, I will have a copy of Tolga's presentation, which has the links and additional information available for people to download. And then also, too, I will have the contact information for Tolga as well, if you would want to reach out to Tolga. Tolga, I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to talk with you this afternoon about corrosion under insulation.
You're welcome, Jim. I also have the honor to be your guest in your YouTube channel. I hope to see you in another subject in corrosion and protective coating topics.
Definitely. Hey, have a great day.
Have a great day, Jim.
So, Joe, for the layperson who's watching this episode, who might only think that corrosion engineering...